हाय दोस्तों, ब्रास ग्रुप के चैनल में आप सभी का स्वागत है। ब्रास ग्रुप आपके लिए लाया एक नया लेसन, आशा करता हूँ आप लोगों को पसंद आएगा। धन्यवाद।
सूट ऑफ सिविल नेचर। नाउ सी बेसिकली व्हाट दिस टॉपिक इज गोइंग टू डील विद इज दैट वी हैव टू वी टॉकिंग अबाउट ओके द सूट विल गो टू दिस कोर्ट एंड दिस कोर्ट एंड दिस कोर्ट, बट फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी शुड नो दैट व्हाट काइंड ऑफ सूट्स कैन गो टू सिविल कोर्ट। सी वी हैव क्रिमिनल कोर्ट्स, वी हैव सिविल कोर्ट्स, वी हैव ट्राइब्यूनल्स, so we have different kinds of code that we have. So first thing that should be clear in our mind is that what kind of suit will go to civil court. Now section 9 tells you that it is a suit of civil nature that will go to a civil court. Now the principal question or the main question which arises in our mind is, what do you mean by a suit of civil nature? You're saying that suit of civil nature will go to civil court, suit of criminal nature will go to criminal court. There are so many things that fall under the ambit or the definition of a civil suit. So how will you kind of find out which matter belongs to civil court or not? So for that, the definition has been given in section 9. So what does section 9 basically declares? See, section 9 is basically a declaratory section which declares that all the suits of civil nature. Now, the main term that you have to find out, you have to keep in mind is that a civil court shall have the jurisdiction to try all the suits. What kind of all suits? Which are of civil nature. So, any suit of civil nature that can be tried by the civil court. However, what are the kind of suits that are of civil nature and still the court cannot try them? Whose cognizance is expressly or impliedly barred? So it is a very generic statement. I'll explain everything. So I'm just starting with the explanation. So just hear me out for some time and then I'll take your questions. Section 9 of CPT says, you can go with any suit of civil nature within double quotes to a civil court. However, even if there is a case, what is a civil nature suit that we'll discuss, but even if there is a suit which is of civil nature, but still you will not be able to go to the civil court if it has been expressly or impliedly barred. If it has been expressly or impliedly prohibited that you cannot take this matter to a civil court. Civil court ka matlab kya hai? Civil court ka matlab hota hai the civil court that you go to and the district courts and all that. Right? Now, we're not covering tribunals here because tribunals have their own jurisdiction. So, we're here concerned only about the civil court. Then, explanation kind of makes this, kind of gives an elaboration on this definition. And let me read out the section very quickly and then I'll come to the explanation part. So, to try all civil suits unless barred. A court shall have, subject to the provisions herein contained, have jurisdiction to try all suits of civil nature, excepting the suits for which their cognizance is either expressly or impliedly barred. So which says the same thing. Civil court can try a suit, all the suits which fall under civil nature. However, even if the suit falls under civil nature, the civil court cannot try it if it has been expressly or impliedly barred. Right? Now then we come to the explanation part. Explanation 1 says, a suit in which the right to property or right to office is contested is a suit of civil nature. Explanation 1 and 2 are basically clarifying the concept of a suit of civil nature. It says that any suit in which there is a right to property or a right to office that is being contested, that is disputed, you want some relief regarding that right to property or right to office, then you will say yes, it is a suit of civil nature. Notwithstanding that such right may depend entirely on the decision of the question as to the religious rites or ceremonies. Then we have explanation 2 which says, for the purpose of this section, it is immaterial whether or not any fees is attached to the office referred to in explanation 1 or whether or not such office is attached to a particular place. So let me explain what do you mean by suit of civil nature. See, a suit of civil nature basically means any suit in which the main question, the principal question that you have to, the court needs to decide, should relate to your civil rights. Right? If the suit needs to give a decision on any matter which is involving your civil rights, then we say that the suit is of civil nature. Now the question comes, what are civil rights? What kind of rights or what kind of matters will come under the definition of a civil right? Right? Now, for example, if I take an illustration of any kind of, let's say there is a breach of contract. Now, breach of contract is something which is your civil right, right? If you want an enforcement of a contract, if there is a breach of contract, you want an enforcement of the contract, that is your civil right. If you want damages from the breach of contract, that is your civil right. If you want a specific performance of the contract, that is again a civil right. Or, for example, you have to assert the right to property. For example, there is a property which belongs to you and somebody is trying to dispossess you from that property. Again, the right to retain that property is your civil right. If there is a right relating to succession, for example, who should succeed to property? Property ke to bahut disputes hote hai na? So all the property dispute, by and large, come under the suit of civil nature because it is dealing with your civil right. For example, succession, who will succeed to the property after the death of the person? So that question is also your civil right. It is so this is also a matter which is falling under civil definition of a civil suit. Any matter which is relating to matrimony, for example, if you want a divorce, then it also comes in your civil right. If you want maintenance, that also comes in your civil right, right? Or if there is a question relating to, let's say, adoption. If a person has adopted a person, adopted a child, so was he competent to adopt? Or was the child capable of being adopted? Or the parents of the child, were they capable of giving the child an adoption? Or this adoption is valid or not? All these rights are related to the civil rights of the parties. Since they are related to the civil rights of the parties, this matter will be a civil matter. This will be a matter which is of civil nature. And since it is a matter of civil nature, the civil court will have the jurisdiction to try it. So when we talk about the matters relating to right to property, right to, specific performance of contract, right to enforcement of contract, right to damages on breach of contract, right to dissolution of marriage, or suits relating to rent, or suits relating to rent, hota hai na, somebody's not paid the rent, then we have rent control acts. Right? For every state, there is a different Rent Control Act. We have Delhi Rent Control Act, Haryana Rent Control Act. For every state, we have that. So, when you're deciding the rights between a tenant and a landlord, then again, it is a matter which is of civil nature. If you're deciding a question relating to partnership, it is again a matter which is of civil nature. Right? If there is a... if somebody has been wrongfully dismissed from the service... Right? So wrongful dismissal from service is again a matter which is affecting your civil rights. Right? So this matter will again fall in the definition of a suit of civil nature. Right? Now another thing which you need to keep in mind and we should be very clear about this fact is, if there is a matter which is purely of religious, political or social question is involved. Right? If there is a matter which involves purely political, civil or religious questions, then that will not be covered under the nature of a civil right. And since it is not covered in the nature of a civil right, in that case, you will not have the right to go to the civil court. For example, let's say there is a place where you're a staunch Hindu who believed in that every kind of puja and every ceremony should be done in a proper manner, right? But let's say in a temple the same procedure is not being followed of puja, kaise prasad chadhate hain, kiska sequence kya hota hai and all that. So that is a matter which is purely religious matter, right? So that does not come, so if you want to go to the court to challenge that, look, this pandit is not following the procedure, right procedure of offering prasad to the deity and he's, not performing the proper ceremonies the way it should be performed. Our shastras say it should be performed in this manner, but he's performing in another manner, which is a modernized version of it, so I do not approve to it, so I want to go to court challenging it. So this is not, this is a purely religious matter, right? So, if the matter is purely religious, or if the matter is purely social, for example, a person has been outcasted, expulsion from the caste, a person has been expelled from the caste. Theek hai, Maliji, there is, we are talking about a village and the person is, his daughter married someone out of the caste. And because of that, this person has been outcasted. His daughter has had a love marriage, or son has had a love marriage. So this person is outcasted and they say, okay, you are not allowed in our community now. So this is a matter which is not affecting your civil rights. This is a purely social question, right? I'll come to these two illustrations one more time and revisit them from a different angle. So just wait for that. For the time being, just understand this thing, that when you talk about a question which is purely... Class, you're with me, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, everyone.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, but this is distorting in between. Beech-beech mein awaaz thoda sa kat raha hai ma'am.
Okay, just go on. Now it will drop.
Okay?
Okay. Now it's better?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, okay, what was I saying? Okay, when you talk about a matter which is purely social or purely religious, that is not a matter which is of civil nature. And since that is not a matter which is of civil nature, you cannot go to a civil court will not have jurisdiction to try that matter, right? However, when I talk about, if I say, is a person having a right to worship? Now, will it fall under a purely civil matter or a religious matter? It would fall under your constitutional right, because Article 25 of the Constitution gives you the right to worship, right? Now, since it is a constitutional right, or it is a right relating to a religion, fine. But it is concerning a religious matter, fine. But then it is a right which has been specifically conferred to you by the Constitution regarding your protection of your religion. Right? In such a case, you can file a suit, or you file writs and all. So right to practice your religion, or right to take out religious processions. So these are the matters which come under the civil nature, because such rights have been guaranteed to you by the Constitution. Now, when I gave you the social law example, if the person has been outcasted and all that, so it is exclusively by and large a social matter. Since it is a social matter, there is no civil right involved per se. So a person cannot go to a civil court and file a suit that, okay, I've been outcasted, people are not talking to me, and people are not coming to my weddings and ceremonies and functions, and they're not inviting me. So if somebody is not inviting a person to their functions and ceremonies, can he go to a court and ask them to invite? Because they're not inviting because my son is married, has a love marriage, and the lady is whatever, out of caste or something. So in this case, the person cannot go to the court to challenge this. However, if there is a discrimination which is happening on the ground of caste, let's say, we have a specific provision of prevention of atrocities against the SCST Act, right? I'm sure you know about it. So if it is a matter where a person is being discriminated or treated badly because of his caste, then it is definitely a matter which goes to, it is a criminal offense now. Right? A person can be prosecuted, and a person can have imprisonment for discriminating or treating a SCST in an inappropriate manner. Right? So please distinguish the differences between these two things. Making a person outcast is a social matter and not a civil right of a person, but discriminating a person on the basis of caste or treating a person, SCST, especially I'm recalled of this act, doing offenses against SCST is definitely an offense, and it is tribal, right? Got the difference between the two? Got the distinction?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. Now, let me just read out some illustrations of what comes under civil suit and what does not. Okay, before that, let me explain you the explanation part. Explanation says a suit to which the right to property or office is involved is a suit of civil nature, right? So if there is any question relating to property or any question as to right to a office is concerned, then it is a suit of civil nature. Even if for the purpose of deciding this question regarding the right to property or right to office, you have to look at certain issues relating to the religious rites or ceremonies. Which means what? If the principal question that needs to be decided in a matter is regarding your civil right, is regarding a property, or it is relating to an office, then it is a sort of civil nature. And the civil court can try it. Even if ye decide karne ke liye ki isko ye property milegi ya nahi milegi, ya fir isko ye, he has a right to this office or not, you will have to look at so many things. And maybe you have to look at the religious rites and ceremonies, or you have to look at religious customs. Then it's fine. But what we are basically concerned about is ki main question decide kya karna hai. If the main question that is to be decided is of a civil nature, then the matter will go to civil court. But for the purpose of deciding this main issue, the civil right, if you have to look into the religious ceremonies or matters, then it is fine. For example, I'm giving you a very hypothetical illustration. Do not bring about the Vaishno Devi case and all that and constitutional law into it. I'm giving a very, very hypothetical illustration. And that is, there's a temple where only Brahmins are allowed, and mostly this is the case where Brahmins are allowed to be priests in temples. However, we do have exceptions. But I'm starting giving this illustration with a disclaimer. I'm not going to go into the constitutional part and validity of this illustration, or is it right or wrong. This is just for explanation purpose. Okay? So, Maliji, there is a temple where only Brahmins can be priests, and that is a kind of rule or a custom that is there. Right? So there are two. There is a person who is wanting to be and there is a, this temple is not a Chhotamota temple. This temple is a. Okay, let me not give a temple example because you will go into constitution and you will get confused. Let me look for another example. Okay, let's take a hypothetical question that there is an office. There is in some office there is a seat. Let's say a chairman of a trust, right? And there are certain rules regarding there are rules governing this trust, or there are certain guidelines given for appointment of a chairman. And one specific guideline is that the chairperson, the person who is taking care of these this trust or this chair, who is holding this chair, should be a person who is a Brahmin. Right? So in such case, if anyone is wanting to contest, anyone is having any dispute regarding the person who's chosen to sit on that chair, and he goes and challenges that I should have been appointed to this position, but I have not been and somebody in my place has been appointed, in such a case, the court will have to decide that, okay, you want to be appointed and you were saying that you can be appointed, but you are not a Brahmin, and the person is required to be a Brahmin, and the person who has been appointed is a Brahmin. So basically, this person was challenging the appointment of the other person as to this chair, and the court has to go into the caste question. I know this is not the best illustration, I'm not satisfied with it, but as and when a good illustration comes to me, I'll tell you. But abhi ke liye itna samajh lo, ye point this should be clear, that if the principal question that needs to be decided by the court is regarding a civil right, right to office or right to property, in such a case, even if for the purpose of deciding it, they have to look at the religious matters or religious ceremony, that is fine. Still, the matter will remain a matter of civil nature because that is the principal question. That is the main issue in this case. If you want to draw a parallel, you can say that criminal law mein hamare paas main issue hota hai aur evidences hote hain. To aap maan lijiye ki jo main issue hai is case mein wo hai civil nature ka, aur jo evidence part mein hoga wo hoga aapka religious rites or ceremonies. Theek hai, this just for the purpose of understanding.
Ma'am, aap ye bolna chahte ho iske andar ki, for an example, ki aapne ek suit file kiya, usme aapke parties ke jo rights hai wo determine ho rahe hain. In case suit ke andar agar as a question of law aa jata hai कि ऐसा इतने टाइम से चला रहा था, फॉर एन एग्जाम्पल सप्तपति इज अ एग्जाम्पल ऑफ मैट्रिमोनियल केसेस, राइट मैम. इन सम स्टेट्स दे डू नॉट फॉलो सप्तपति, इन हरियाणा, इन मैनी अदर स्टेट्स ऑल्सो. सो दिस इज नॉट द क्वेश्चन ऑफ राइट्स ऑफ द पार्टी, दिस इज अ क्वेश्चन ऑफ कस्टम. So that will not the civil in nature, that will a question of...
No, you have given me a good example, but I'll rephrase it. See, for example, switch off your mic please, my voice starts echoing. Okay. For example, if a person has to decide on the validity of, okay, a person goes to, has to decide on a matter goes to the court deciding about the validity of a marriage. Theek hai? A validity of the marriage is a civil right. It is a matter which is a civil suit. Now, for the purpose of deciding whether the marriage is a valid marriage or not, the court has to go into the question of religious rites and ceremonies, which means that the court has to go into the question whether Satpadi was followed or not, whether proper ceremonies of marriage, because for a Hindu marriage, ceremonies have to be done. So whether the ceremonies were actually done or not. So I think this is the best illustration I can give to explain you this point, that aapka right kya hai, civil right, that you are going to decide the validity of marriage. Is it a civil matter? Definitely it is a civil matter. But for the purpose of deciding the civil matter, you will have to go into the question of religious rites and ceremonies. आपको देखना पड़ेगा कि सेरेमनीज हुई थी या नहीं हुई थी, सतपति हुई थी या नहीं हुई थी, सतपति का प्रोविजन है या नहीं है, इज देयर अ कस्टम और नॉट. गॉट इट क्लास? ओके, नाउ लेट मी कम टू द लिस्ट ऑफ इश्यूज विच आर लिस्ट ऑफ सम. आई विल गिव सम इलस्ट्रेशन विच विल से दिस इज अ केस ऑफ सिविल नेचर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, सूट्स रिलेटेड टू प्रॉपर्टी, सूट्स रिलेटेड टू राइट टू वर्शिप. I think I've given you this list. Now I'll give you a list of suits which are not of civil nature. A suit involving purely religious rites, a question relating to purely religious rites or ceremony, or a question relating to expulsion from castes, right? Or questions relating to recovery of voluntary payment offering. आप मंदिर में जाके चढ़ावा चढ़ा देते हैं, ठीक है? You give मंदिर 1,00,000 रुपए आपने दे दिए चढ़ावा. Now you want to recover that money. So you cannot claim it is a matter of right. Okay, I've offered money. Now I want to reclaim this money. That is not a civil right. Fine. Now let's come to a very important part of Section 9, and that talks about express or implied power. See, Section 9 very clearly says that all the suits of civil nature can go to civil court. unless they are barred either expressly or impliedly. Now, what do you mean by barred either expressly or impliedly? Barred expressly means that there is the law which we are dealing with, the statute which we are dealing with, expressly makes the provision or expressly declares that the matters relating to this particular statute cannot go to a civil court. It can be decided only by us. They would have some authority which would decide. For example, let's take the example of, we are going to do a case, Gondanji, abhi bhi karenge hum. For example, if there are matters relating to rent, right, matters relating to the tenant and the landlord, then it is expressly given in the Rent Control Act that the matter will go only to the rent tribunal. It will not go to a civil, you cannot go and file a suit in the civil court saying, ki mere tenant ko nikalo, he has not paid me rent for say 3 months, evict him from the premises. Is it a civil right? Tell me, class. Is it a civil right or not?
Yes, ma'am.
This is a civil right.
It is definitely a civil right, but still, can a person go to a civil court or not? No. And why can't he go to the, civil court? He cannot go to a civil court because it has been expressly barred by the statute or by the law which is dealing with such matters, right? So we have several tribunals, like we have income tax ke matters, labor law ke matters, we have company law matters, we have rent control matters, right? So these are some of the examples where the statute expressly bars that if there is any dispute which arises with respect to the matter which is dealt in our statute, then the person cannot go to the civil court because the matter will be decided by us and us only. Right? So, is case mein kya hai? Is case mein the suit is of civil nature? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Definitely. It is a suit of civil nature. But can a person go to civil court?
No.
Why no? Because it has been expressly barred. Fine? Now, impliedly barred kya hota hai? Impliedly barred is when there are some specific, for example, we have Contract Act, mein we have Section 23 which says, if we cannot go to the court for enforcing a matter which is for immoral purpose or something like that. So, if there is an implied bar, then also the person cannot go to the court. Or if the tribunal does not exclude the jurisdiction, but the tribunal basically provides for all the remedy. But a specific line tribunal, for example, rent control tribunal, usme the specific line is not written that you cannot go to the court, but the tribunal is providing all the remedy that there is a court we have established, this is the jurisdiction of the court, everything that they have said, in such a case it acts as a implied bar. So let me sum it up and then I'm going to, let me give a summary of what I've told you.
Can we go for appeal also?
Yes, they have provision for appeal also. Rather, many appeals ka provision hota hai, right? Okay. So, summing it up, Section 9, and then we'll go to the case, very interesting case. Section 9 says, all suits of civil nature, civil court can try. But even if a suit is of civil nature, you cannot try it if it has been expressly or impliedly barred. When you look at a suit of civil nature, wo kya hota hai? Which is deciding your civil rights, right? If there is a question which is purely religious or purely social or purely political, that matter does not come into the definition of a civil right. Next very important point that you need to understand is, if the main question that has to be decided is regarding your civil rights, so usko decide karne ke liye, even if the court has to look at the religious rites and ceremonies, still it will remain a matter which is of civil nature and civil court will have jurisdiction. And then the example of validity of marriage will come. Fine till now? Any questions quickly ask because I want to go to case then.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yes, good morning. Tell me.
Ma'am, the matters of writ petition will fall either in
civil
nature.
See that writ petition if you want. So, writ petition can be any writ petition.
Yeah, exactly. Because if the writ petition is being filed for the criminal case, then it would fall under that.
So it can be any. It basically deals with the jurisdiction of the courts as such. So it can be civil also, it can be criminal also.
Alright, ma'am.
Fine?
Ma'am, I'm not clear with this point that you gave the example of SCST Atrocity Act, but this is a criminal offense against a person.
That's right. Either it's only for the purpose of explanation. रिपिटेशन आई एम गिविंग एग्जांपल, इट इज नॉट सिविल मैटर. आई टोल्ड यू क्रिमिनल होता है उसमें पनिशमेंट का प्रोविजन होता है. इट वॉज ओनली फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ एक्सप्लेनेशन दैट आई ड्रॉ एन एनालॉजी.
ओके मैम,
राइट अंजलि.
सो वन मोर थिंग
नाउ, लेट यस टेल मी अबाउट
मैम, ये जो डेफिनेशन दिया है कि ईदर एक्सप्रेसली और इंप्लाइडली बैड. मैम बट जब कोई ट्राइब्यूनल का कोई डिसीजन आता है तो उसको तो आप चैलेंज भी कर सकते हो ना इन अ कोर्ट.
लेकिन चैलेंज आप सिविल कोर्ट में नहीं कर सकते, आप उसे चैलेंज ट्राइब्यूनल के थ्रू ही कर सकते हो. ट्राइब्यूनल्स में अपील का सिस्टम होता है.
ओके ओके
राइट. No, no, you cannot. You cannot. See, there are tribunals mein hi pata, the tribunal will tell you where will the appeal go. For example, if the rent tribunal is deciding a case regarding a tenant and landlord right, then the matter will go to the rent tribunal. If the person is not satisfied, then we have appellate rent tribunal. If the appellate rent tribunal ki decision says you are not satisfied, then it says now the appeal will go to the high court. That's how they only provide the hierarchy of courts in that sense. Fine?
All
right,
ma'am. Ma'am, what is the meaning right to office here in this section?
Right to office? That means you have a right or a claim to a particular office. Right? Okay.
Not
then
clear,
we come to the case. Ma'am. Right to office means you have a right to a particular office.
Ma'am, can you please explain when cognizance is impliedly barred?
Cognizance is impliedly barred. Let's say there is a tribunal which gives you all the remedies. There is a statute which is giving you remedies, but it is not expressly saying that a person cannot go to the court. Right? So this means that it is impliedly barred because you need to approach the specific court before going to a generic court. So that would mean impliedly barred. Right? The tribunal is not excluding the jurisdiction, but the statute is providing for exhaustive remedies. The statute is giving you exhaustive remedies. What will you do if this right is infringed? We have a court, we have provision for appeal, everything it is giving, but it is not specifically declaring that this court will not have the jurisdiction.
Okay.
Now, let me come to the case of Gondaji Satwaji Shinde versus Ram Chandra Bikaji. Now, this is a case, this is a case given in your case material. Have you got your case material or a link to case material?
For the yeah. materials, ma'am, we haven't got any link. The link that is being provided is for the 2016-17 case marks.
Okay, I'm sure very soon you'll get a updated one also. So, in the meanwhile, I think it should be there. This case should be there in the 16-wala case material also. Okay, let me come to this case. Now, this case got, the name is, this is the first case in your case material. Gondaji Satwaji Shinde versus Ram Chandra Tikaji. Now, the facts of this case are, there is a person for this, we'll call him plaintiff. Plaintiff and defendant basically entered into an agreement to buy the land. Plaintiff was buying a land from the defendant, and the plaintiff had already paid the advance also. 5,000 ek bar diya, 5,000 dubara diya, right? So, here he has given the advance money also. And the defendant accepted that advance money. But when it came to selling the land and entering into a sale deed, then the defendant refused. Right? So defendant was selling a land to plaintiff, they entered into agreement, plaintiff paid advance money also, but then the defendant refused to sell the land to the plaintiff. So plaintiff approached the court. And what he wanted the specific performance of contract. The specific performance means that, look, we entered into an agreement to sell. Now this person is, I've given him advance money also. Now he's refusing to sell his land to me. So ask this person to sell the land to me. Right? So that is what the person plaintiff was asking. So this person said that, look, I am an agriculturalist. This land that we are talking about, the defendant took a plea in the court that, look, the land that we are talking about falls under the, falls in, this is in Kolhapur basically, and this land comes under Bombay Tenancy Act. This land is governed by Bombay Tenancy, this is the full name of it, I'm using the short form, Bombay Tenancy Act. And section 63 of this act, of this Bombay Tenancy Act, very clearly declares that land can be sold only and only to an agriculturist, right? We have such provisions in a lot of tenancy acts, In fact, if you remember, there was a controversy regarding Amitabh Bachchan also buying some land in UP, because there was a provision in UP Tenancy Act also that this land, agricultural land, can be bought only by a person who's an agriculturist. Right? So it was contended that Amitabh Bachchan is not an agriculturist, so he's not eligible to buy this land. So similarly, there was a provision in Bombay Tenancy Act also that Section 63 of this Act provided that the land can be sold only and only to an agriculturist. And the defendant took a plea in the court that plaintiff is actually not an agriculturist. Since plaintiff is not an agriculturist, how can I sell a land to him? Even if there's agreement and all that, that's fine. But I cannot violate the provisions of the Act. The Act does not allow it. And my land is governed by the Bombay Tenancy Act. So, since Section 63 of this Act is barring that a land can be sold only to an agriculturist or a defendant to agriculturist, so I cannot send this land to him. Right? So this, what did the plaintiff do? The plaintiff basically produced a certificate. And the certificate was given by Mamlatdar. Now, Mamlatdar is like a land revenue officer that you have under the Tenancy Act. जैसे कि तहसीलदार वगैरह होते हैं ना, तो वैसे ही मामलतदार होता है लैंड मैटर्स के लिए, राइट? सो दिस प्लेंटिफ प्रोड्यूस्ड अ डॉक्यूमेंट गिवन बाय द मामलतदार विच बेसिकली डिक्लेयर्ड दैट प्लेंटिफ इज एक्चुअली अ एग्रीकल्चरिस्ट. सो दिस वाज अ सर्टिफिकेशन ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट प्लेंटिफ इज अ एग्रीकल्चरिस्ट. सो द प्लेंटिफ कंटेंडेड इन द कोर्ट दैट लुक, पहली बात तो मेरे पास सर्टिफिकेट है विच इज गिवन फ्रॉम द मामलतदार. सेकेंड ऑफ ऑल, even if I do not have the certificate or even if the court does not believe in the certificate, then also we have Section 70 Clause A of the Tenancy Act, we have Section 85 of the Tenancy Act, and we have Section 85 Capital A of the Tenancy Act. And these sections, Section 70 Clause A, Section 85 and Section 85 Capital A of the Tenancy Act, they basically specifically declare that civil court does not have the jurisdiction to decide the matter relating to this particular fact. That is all the matters that are dealt in Tenancy Act, which includes the question of deciding whether the person is an agriculturist or not. This does not fall within the jurisdiction of a civil court, but this only Mamlatdar can decide under the Tenancy Act. So, जो भी matter है, the civil court has no right to decide whether I am an agriculturist or not. It is only Mamlatdar who can decide. So, civil court ने क्या बोला? Civil court said no. We are agreeing what the defendant has to say, and defendant has and we decide that you are not an agriculturist. And how can we decide? We can decide because देखो main issue क्या है इस case में? Main issue इस case में है regarding the specific performance of a contract. Now, specific contract का तो decide करने का हमारे पास jurisdiction है. Now we have an ancillary or an incidental question also that we need to decide, and that is whether the defendant is an agriculturist or not. And this question we can decide because it is only an incidental question. Why is there is a need for us to go to the Mamlatdar and all that? Even if the Act specifically bars that this matter can be decided only by a Mamlatdar, that whether a person is agriculturist or not, still, it is only an ancillary matter, so we can decide that Section 9 of CPC does not bar us from deciding the question regarding the fact whether the defendant is an agriculturist or not. So, this court gave a decision, and in this decision, the civil court declared that yes, basically the district court has case mein, usne declared kar diya that the plaintiff is not an agriculturist, and so you cannot, so there is no need of specific performance. Then the person went to High Court. High Court also agreed with the decision which was given by the lower court that yes, the person is not an agriculturist, so no specific performance. Or jahan tak baat aati hai, ye decide karne ki that, you know, Section 70A and 85 and 85A are declaring that the civil court has no jurisdiction. So we do not agree with it because this is only an incidental matter. Is case mein main issue to yahi hai that whether the specific performance can be done or not. Right? यहाँ तक क्लियर है, देन आई गो टू द सुप्रीम कोर्ट. प्लस एनी डाउट स्टिल हियर प्लीज आस्क इन द पास्ट फॉर अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ समथिंग. एनीवन सॉरी, व्हाट अबाउट द
मनी? वी हैड ऑलरेडी टेकन इन एडवांस.
वी आर नॉट इवन गोइंग इनटू दैट. वी आर कंसर्न ओनली अबाउट द जुरिसडिक्शन पार्ट. मनी तो ऑब्वियसली स्पेसिफिक फॉर्म नहीं होगा, मनी वापस करेगा वो, दैट्स इंप्लाइड.
ओके,
ठीक है, लेकिन अभी ये समझ में आया मैटर क्या है, क्या सर यू अंडरस्टूड और नॉट? क्लियर? ओके फाइन, ओके 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 गुड. So let's go to what happened then. After the High Court also agreed with the District Court, the person approached the Supreme Court. He filed an SLP in the Supreme Court. Now the issue before the Supreme Court was, the Supreme Court has to basically decide on the jurisdiction part, that whether the person is an agriculturist or not, does the Civil Court have jurisdiction to decide this matter or not, since it has been expressly barred by the Bombay Tenancy Act. Supreme Court कहते हैं चलो ठीक है, let's look at the sections and decide. First it looked at section 3, section 63. Section 63 very clearly says that the land which is falling under this act, this tenancy act, it cannot be sold to a person who is not an agriculturist. So this thing was very clear कि land sale करने के लिए the person has to be a agriculturist. Second they looked at section 70 clause A. Section 70 clause A declares, if any dispute arises in this regard, jurisdiction to decide is only with the mamlatdar, right? So section 70 clause A is also saying that any dispute which is arising, then only mamlatdar can decide. Then they looked at section 85. What does it say? It says that jurisdiction of civil court is barred in such matters. So section 85 have kind of specifically, section 70 ने क्या कहा कि मामलतदार decide करेगा, 85 ने क्या कहा that the jurisdiction of civil court is barred in such matter, right? Then section 85A went one step ahead. It was like a, you know, reiterating the fact again and again. Section 85 capital A says, if there is a court which is faced with such a matter and such an issue, that whether a person is agriculturist or not, in that case, the civil court should send a reference of this matter to the mamlatdar. Mamlatdar will decide it. After deciding it, the mamlatdar will send the decision to the court, and thereafter the court can dispose of the rest of the case. See too? So section 85 makes the procedure also very clear. So basically, section 70 kehta hai only mamlatdar is having jurisdiction. 85 kehta hai jurisdiction of Supreme Court is civil court is barred. 85A kehta hai if such matter comes, then the person has to approach the court has to approach the mamlatdar. He will decide this issue. Agriculturist है या नहीं है, उसके बाद they send it to the court, और जो बाकी का matter है specific performance का, then the court will decide. ठीक है? So in this case, the basic issue before the Supreme Court was whether the jurisdiction of the civil court, this issue can be decided by the jurisdiction of civil court or not. Here the Supreme Court say, look, if we look at these provisions, Section 70 clause A, 85 and 85A, it becomes absolutely clear, clear that the jurisdiction of civil court is expressly barred. And when we have such provision where the jurisdiction of the court is strictly and absolutely barred, then we cannot have a liberal approach ki chalo koi baat nahi decide kar lete hain. In such cases, the court has to adhere to it in a very strict sense, which means the court, civil court cannot take up this issue. The civil court cannot decide this issue. Right? In fact, there are so many cases that are cited in this case. One of the cases which is cited is Dondi Tukaram Mali versus Dadu Piraji Adgale. I'm repeating the name. A case which is cited in this case, that is Dondi Tukaram Mali versus Dadu Piraji Adgale. Now, in this case, actually, this is an old case. This is a 1954 ka case. Now, in the case with Dondi Tukaram, kya tha? There was only section 70A and 85 was involved. Right? And the court gave the decision only on the basis of 70A and 85 only. The civil court will not have the jurisdiction and only this mamlatdar can decide such matter. And this case also recommended, this is a high court ka decision. In this case, the Bombay High Court also recommended that the legislature should make such provision which is making this jurisdiction part clear and expressly barring. Halaki ye likha to hua hi hai, lekin ek bahut hi clear cut provision should also be made. And this is only after this judgment that an amendment was made in section 85, and section 85A was added to this act. Aur section 85A kya kehta hai, which says ki agar koi aisa matter aa bhi jata hai civil court ke paas, they have to refer the matter to mamlatdar, take the decision from the mamlatdar, and the mamlatdar will give his decision to the civil court, and on the basis of that they can decide the rest of the case. Fine class. So in this case, what did the Supreme Court say? The Supreme Court said that the civil court in such a case should have sent, when the matter comes to deciding whether a person is agriculturist or not, the court should have sent the matter back to the Mamlatdar, waited for the decision of Mamlatdar, and only on the basis of the decision of the Mamlatdar, if he declares that the person is an egregious, so unko specific performance ka issue decide karna chahiye tha. Dear students,
ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, suppose if section 85A was not there, the section only...
Still, even if, Anjali, even if section 85A was not there, section 70 clause A and 85 are sufficient to bar, because 85 aap padhoge, to usme expressly likha hua hai, civil court will not have a jurisdiction to try this case.
Got it, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, class at 10:30, fine. Okay, got it. So, this case, please, I have explained this case, please read it. And this key attendance will be here, quickly put it in the chat box, very quickly. Suit of civil nature. Now, see, basically what this topic is going to deal with is that we're talking about, okay, the suit will go to this court and this court and this court. But first of all, we should know that what kind of suit can go to civil courts. See, we have criminal courts, we have civil courts, we have tribunals. So we have different kinds of court that we have. So first thing that should be clear in our mind is that what kind of suit will go to civil court. Now section 9 tells you that it is a suit of civil nature that will go to a civil court. Now the principal question or the main question which arises in our mind is, what do you mean by a suit of civil nature? You're saying that suit of civil nature will go to civil court, suit of criminal nature will go to criminal court. There are so many things that fall under the ambit or the definition of a civil suit. So how will you kind of find out which matter belongs to civil court or not? So for that, the definition has been given in section 9. So what does section 9 basically declares? See, section 9 is basically a declaratory section which declares that all the suits of civil nature... Now, the main term that you have to find out, you have to keep in mind is that a civil court shall have the jurisdiction to try all the suits. What kind of all suits? Which are of civil nature. So, any suit of civil nature, that can be tried by the civil court. However, what are the kind of suits that are of civil nature and still the court cannot try them? Whose cognizance is expressly or impliedly barred? So it is a very generic statement. I'll explain everything. So I'm just starting with the explanation. So just hear me out for some time and then I'll take your questions. Section 9 of CPT says, you can go with any suit of civil nature within double quotes to a civil court. However, even if there is a case, what is a civil nature suit that we'll discuss, but even if there is a suit which is of civil nature, but still you will not be able to go to the civil court if it has been expressly or impliedly barred. If it has been expressly or impliedly prohibited, that you cannot take this matter to a civil court. Civil court ka matlab kya hai? Civil court ka matlab hota hai the civil court that you go to and the district courts and all that. Right? Now, we're not covering tribunals here because tribunals have their own jurisdiction. So, we're here concerned only about the civil court. Then, explanation kind of makes this, kind of gives an elaboration on this definition. And let me read out the section very quickly and then I'll come to the explanation part. Civil suits unless barred. A court shall have, subject to the provisions herein contained, have jurisdiction to try all suits of civil nature, excepting the suits for which their cognizance is either expressly or impliedly barred. So which says the same thing. Civil court can try a suit, all the suits which fall under civil nature. However, even if the suit falls under civil nature, the civil court cannot try it if it has been expressly or impliedly barred. Right? Now then we come to the explanation part. Explanation 1 says, a suit in which the right to property or right to office is contested is a suit of civil nature. Explanation 1 and 2 are basically clarifying the concept of a suit of civil nature. It says that any suit in which there is a right to property or a right to office that is being contested, that is disputed, you want some relief regarding that right to property or right to office, then you will say yes, it is a suit of civil nature. Notwithstanding that such right may depend entirely on the decision of the question as to the religious rights or ceremonies. Then we have explanation 2, which says, for the purpose of this section, it is immaterial whether or not any fees is attached to the office referred to in explanation 1 or whether or not such office is attached to a particular place. So let me explain what do you mean by suit of civil nature. See, a suit of civil nature basically means any suit in which the main question, the principal question that you have to, the court needs to decide, should relate to your civil rights. Right? If the suit needs to give a decision on any matter which is involving your civil rights, then we say that the suit is of civil nature. Now the question comes, what are civil rights? What kind of rights or what kind of matters will come under the definition of a civil right? Right? Now, for example, if I take an illustration of any kind of, let's say there is a breach of contract. Now, breach of contract is something which is your civil right. Right? If you want an enforcement of a contract, if there is a breach of contract, you want an enforcement of the contract, that is your civil right. If you want damages from the breach of contract, that is your civil right. If you want a specific performance of the contract, that is again a civil right. Or, for example, you have to assert the right to property. For example, there is a property which belongs to you and somebody is trying to dispossess you from that property. Again, the right to retain that property is your civil right. If there is a right relating to succession, for example, who should succeed to property? Property ke to bahut disputes hote hai na? So all the property disputes, by and large, come under the suit of civil nature because it is dealing with your civil right. For example, succession, who will succeed to the property after the death of the person? So that question is also your civil right. It is so this is also a matter which is falling under civil definition of a civil suit. Any matter which is relating to matrimony, for example, if you want a divorce, then it also comes in your civil right. If you want maintenance, that also comes in your civil right, right? Or if there is a question relating to, let's say, adoption. If a person has adopted a person, adopted a child, so was he competent to adopt? Or was the child capable of being adopted? Or the parents of the child, were they capable of giving the child an adoption? Or this adoption is valid or not? All these rights are related to the civil rights of the parties. Since they are related to the civil rights of the parties, this matter will be a civil matter. This will be a matter which is of civil nature. And since it is a matter of civil nature, the civil court will have the jurisdiction to try it. So when we talk about the matters relating to right to property, right to, specific performance of contract, right to enforcement of contract, right to damages on breach of contract, right to dissolution of marriage, or suits relating to rent. Or suits relating to rent, hota hai na, somebody's not paid the rent, then we have rent control acts. Right? For every state, there is a different rent control act. We have Delhi Rent Control Act, Haryana Rent Control Act. For every state, we have that. So when you're deciding the rights between a tenant and a landlord, then again, it is a matter which is of civil nature. If you're deciding a question relating to partnership, it is again a matter which is of civil nature. Right? If there is a... Okay, now the if somebody has been wrongfully dismissed from the service...
दोस्तों ब्रास ग्रुप आशा करता है कि आप सभी लोगों को ये लेसन पसंद आया होगा। आप अपना फीडबैक कमेंट बॉक्स में देना न भूलें। थैंक्स फॉर वॉचिंग।